It all starts with the name Edward Henry Harriman, also known by his initials, E.H. Harriman. That name for most does not ring a bell. He was born on February 20th, 1848, and died on September 9th, 1909. This historical figure, whose identity has been swept underneath the carpet, was a monumentous individual who helped shape the world for what it is today. One of the top industrial kings of the 19th century. To begin with such a forgotten figure, his backstory needs some discussion. He was no special child, one who grew up with normal parents, in a regular household, like every other American family. Growing up as a young New Yorker, lusting for a ravishing lifestyle, Harriman spent his first few summers working at the Greenwood Iron Furnace, a smelting site for iron and ore, which was mined from nearby vines owned by Robert Perrin and his family. After taking up this job at such a young age, gathering work experience, and even quite a bit of pocket change, Ed quit school at the age of 14 to take up a job as an errand boy on Wall Street, thanks to his uncle, Oliver Harriman. For the next 8 years, Ed worked his way up through each tier, surprising many along the way as to how committed he really was for this being his full occupation, to the point where he was finally given an opening as a member of the New York Stock Exchange, to which he accepted. Nearly a decade later, he caught the eye of a girl whose father accepted Ed's proposal due to his powerful position on the national market. At the age of 31, he married Mary Williamson Averill, whose father, William J. Averill, opened the opportunity for a fortune which would forever change how America operated. Now, it's important to note, this was not the business itself. Though significant, it was what he did before buying the business that sparked the Industrial Revolution. J. Averill was the president of the Odzenberg and Lake Champlain Railroad system. And it was by this time, 2 years passing into his marriage, that he took up the company as it was beginning to break down into a catastrophic rusty hellscape. Harriman saw a chance in taking up the business because he envisioned what the world could be if everyone rode trains across the continent. Businesses would boom, and more opportunity would open. However, buying a railroad at the age of 33 and already planning to snowball it into the next big success was more than a risk and nearly impossible to achieve in any situation unless you had a bank account with unlimited funds. So, the big question of the day is, where do you get unlimited funds? Harriman was genuinely the first industrial giant, and he got there because he calculated a strategic plan to borrow money from one of the richest families to have ever lived, the Rothschilds. Who are the Rothschilds, and why were they such a significant factor in the success of E.H. Harriman? The Rothschild family are of Ashkenazi Jewish heritage, and their forefather, Mayor Amschel Rothschild, known as the Father of Finance, established the international banking system in the 1760s. He was the creator of modern currency and soon a shareholder of billions of funds consisting of many countries. It was because Ed had family dating back to the early stages of American banking that he was able to weave his way through many obstacles. One of those obstacles was not being born a Jew. However, hearing about the deal with Harriman's father-in-law and requests for loans through the bank he worked in, German-born Jewish banker Jacob Schiff called Harriman to step into his office. The pro-financer, who had ties to the Rothschilds, wanted to hear out Ed's plan of action. And it went like this. What if some of the wealthiest industrialists worked together to create an international railroad system? And here they were. Rockefeller, who owned close to 60% of all American oil at the time, Carnegie, who operated nearly every steel factory across the peninsula, John Pierpont Morgan, who struck out on his own and created a new bank called J.P. Morgan & Company, which was used to coordinate the sale of stocks and bonds for the countless investors who wanted in on the American railroads, and James Jerome Hill, who was a railroad executive of his own company, a warehouse filled with cheaper boat and train components. Skeptical at first, though intrigued, Jacob did not understand Harriman's intentions, to which Ed emphasized that they will buy off each other and eventually create an industrial food chain that would circle back to them as they would own the whole railroad business itself. Jacob called property financer James Stillman, who proposed he could own shares of this company if he began buying out large chunks of unused wetlands to stretch Harriman's new business across a vast array of cities. Knowing how successful Vanderbilt was back in the 1820s, the two figured it could become an empire. Nearing an agreement, Schiff attempted to include Morgan and Hill by requesting Morgan to give 1/3 of investments into the whole operation and lowered prices off Hill's warehouse implements to get a strong head start. They both declined, which left Carnegie, John D. Rockefeller, and his cousin, William Rockefeller, open for discussion. It's not clear whether all six men assembled in a single room and came to an agreement. However, what is true is the communication they had regarding hundreds of purchased materials conveniently and specifically off Rockefeller and Carnegie's estate. And so all three agreed and began an operation consisting of steam engine locomotives. This eventually orchestrated into a silent cartel capable of buying off one another through taxpayer money. Assembled by Carnegie, fueled by the Rockefellers, built on Stillman Real Estate, funded by Jacob Schiff, while being managed by Harriman, owner of what was now known as the Sodas Bay and Southern Railroad. The Sodas Bay and Southern Railroad. Known as the Sodas Bay and Southern Railroad, established in 1833. Established in 1883. This was the juncture that jumped Harriman's career into the field of rebuilding bankrupt rail. Into the field of rebuilding bankrupt railroads. But the holder of the dice, the ones behind the curtains, who oversaw its growth, and were nearly a close 79% owner of the Harriman scheme was, of course, the Rothschilds. Specifically, Alphonse James de Rothschild, his son, Edouard James, along with Leopold de Rothschild and his brother, first Baron Nathaniel Rothschild. along with Leopold de Rothschild and his brother, first Baron Nathaniel Rothschild. Although many other Rothschilds were alive, most were either too young or in retirement to take part in this ownership. It was these men who were in charge of the funds that were loaned from by Jacob and James, because those exact loans came from their company banks located in London and Germany.